So our next speaker is Lise Compte, and Lise is from the University of Tennessee, Knoxville in USA, and she's going to talk about Some Like It Hot and Slow, How Vulnerable Are Freshwater Fishes to Climate Change. Welcome.
Thank you very much. So thank you for the introduction, and thank you very much to FishBase for inviting me. I'm really excited this morning to have the opportunity to present some of my research about the vulnerability of freshwater fish to climate change. Okay. So we all know that the global climate around the globe is changing, and it's increasing. We have seen an increase of okay, well, 0.85 degrees since pre-industrial levels, and it is increasingly likely that these changes are not going to stop. And actually, now we might see an increase of about 2 to 4 degrees Celsius by the end of the century. And about 10 years ago, we started to see in the literature really alarmist prediction about the impact of climate change on biodiversity, with even some predicting six mass extinction. So the question is, how bad is it going to be? Can we assume that all the species, all the geographical areas are going to be equally affected by these changes in the environment? So to tackle these complicated questions, the scientists came with the concept of climatic vulnerability that they define as a combination of three different facets: the exposure to the change, the sensitivity, and the capacity, the adaptive capacity of species to cope, to buffer these changes in their environment. So regarding the first facet, the exposure to climate change, it is usually easy to understand and to quantify, and it's typically done by using the magnitude and or direction of the predicted changes. So for example, the changes in mean temperature or precipitation in a certain point in time. And a metric that is commonly used is to look at the rate of the isotherm shift through space that is called the velocity of climate change. And it's typically used to quantify the rates at which the organisms will have to respond to these changes. Regarding the second facet, the intrinsic sensitivity of the species, an angle that is usually taken is to look at the physiological sensitivity, and in particular at how far species live from their thermal limits. So this is typically quantified using the difference between a metric that is the critical thermal maxima here, usually the lethal limit of the different species, and the temperature that are seen across their ranges. And there's this common assumption that tropical species will be the most at risk from climate change because they have evolved under really stable climate regimes. And as such, they already live really close to these thermal limits. While species living at relatively higher latitudes, because they have been subjected to a really viable climate regime, they live really far away from these limits, and so they could potentially withstand a huge, like not huge, but a bigger change in the temperatures. So regarding the last facet, the adaptive capacity, this one is probably the most difficult one to understand and to quantify. Because a species that is going to be exposed to a change in its environment is going to be able to show different kind of responses. The first one is to move, which what is called the distributional range shifts. So in this case, the species are going to shift their distributional range and to be able to follow the shifting isotherms through space. But another kind of response that might be expected is the phenotypic or genetic adaptations. So in this case, the species are going to stay put and to be able to show evolutionary adaptations to these changes in their environment. We have still much to learn about these different kinds of responses, but we can still think that these kind of responses and the magnitude of these responses are going to be mediated somehow by the intrinsic characteristics of species. The first candidate is the dispersal ability of species. Indeed, we cannot expect that all the species are going to be able to shift at the same rate and to move to follow the climate. Other characteristic that we might want to consider is the ecological specialization. So, for example, if a species is really specialized in a particular food source, whether or not this food source might disappear in the future or might shift with the species, allowing it to continue to eat. And other considerations might be related to the size of the population or their genetic diversity, which will allow evolutionary rescues. Something that we tend to forget is also the human context in which these changes are occurring. Indeed, it is really naive to believe that climate change is going to occur in isolation from other threats. And many organisms, among which freshwater fish, are exposed already to multiple pressures, such as commercial exploitation, pollution, the fragmentation of their environment by dams, and also the replacement of the riparian forest by agricultural lands. So these are factors that we have to consider to really understand the climatic vulnerability of species. So with all these tools and concepts in mind, what do we really know about the climatic vulnerability of biodiversity in general? Well, it turns out that we still know little. According to this study that has been published a few years ago by Pacifici and collaborators, they reviewed the literature to try to understand what we knew about the vulnerability of different kinds of organisms. And they found that only 4% of the studies, for example, were conducted at the global scale, meaning that our understanding of the geography of climatic vulnerability were still really poor. And more interestingly, at least in my point of view, they showed that all these studies that were published, so assessing the climatic vulnerability of organisms, were conducted for terrestrial organisms, which means that our understanding of the vulnerability of freshwater organisms, among which freshwater fish, was really uncertain. Still from the literature, we now know that distributional range shifts, so the movements of the species to follow climate change, are one of the primary responses of the species, if not the main response of species to climate change. And in this seminal meta-analysis by Chen and collaborators that was published in 2011 in Science, they tried to quantify the rates at which the organisms were moving their distribution. And they compiled range shift estimates for many different terrestrial groups. And they showed that, on average, the species had moved at a mean rate of 11 meters per decade towards higher elevation, and at a mean rate of 17 kilometers per decade towards the pole, so towards cooler areas. But this meta-analysis concerned only terrestrial organisms. And we know that freshwater organisms and riverine organisms are highly constrained within river networks, meaning that following the change in climate for them might be extremely difficult. Indeed, they cannot jump from one river basin to another one, and often the direction of the network is not from south to north, meaning that they cannot really shift towards higher latitudes as the terrestrial organisms. So the question was to determine whether freshwater fish were already affected by climate change, and were they able to shift their range to follow these changes in their environment? Sorry. So I propose today to present evidence related to these two questions. And I split my talk into two different parts. The first one related to a study that I conducted at the University of Washington, and in which we assessed the global vulnerability of freshwater fish to climate change that we did like all around the world in different rivers. And in the second part of my talk, I'm going to present and discuss evidence about the recent effects of climate change on freshwater fish. So starting with the global vulnerability assessment, we wanted to provide like an assessment as comprehensive as possible. So what we did was first to look at the literature and to try to collect information about the thermal, so lethal limits of freshwater fish. And by doing this literature review, we found more than 2,000 thermal challenges that represented a total of about 500 fish species. And based on these values that were like obtained under laboratory conditions, we were able to reproduce these thermal response curves that you can see here that describe the changes in the physiological limits, so the critical thermal maxima, as a function of the temperature of acclimation. So in these experiments, typically what is done is to put the fish in a tank and to increase the temperature and to see at which temperature they start to die. There's different way to measure it, but the way is still to find what are the lethal limits. But so by describing these curves, we can have a better understanding of what are the physiological limits, but also what is the acclimation ability of species, so meaning their ability to increase this thermal limit when exposed to increased temperature. And so in parallel, we collected information about the distributions of species, so mainly using already estimated range maps from the IUCN, and also information about the water temperature across the different streams and rivers of the world. And because we were working with this data coming from experiments, but some of them were not really representative of the conditions occurring across species ranges. For example, on this graphic, you can see that for some species, the experiments were conducted like at about 1 or 2 degrees Celsius, which never occur like across the range of this particular species. So we wanted something to be representative of the habitat of this species. And so we decided to restrict the window along these thermal curves to a window representative of the temperature experienced by species during summer across their range. And next, because we collected information of about only 500 fish species, but we know that there's many more fish species and we wanted to have a better coverage in our global assessment. So we decided to use a phylogenetic-based data imputation procedure. So I'm not going to describe this procedure, but the concept of it is to use the fact that closely related species, they tend to share the same thermal limits. And so we use this property to predict the missing values for many other species across the tree of life. And so we used this CTmax that we predicted as a function of the ancestry relationships across species. And at the end of the process, we obtained the CTmax values, so we estimated for more than 2,000 freshwater fish species. So we actually run this analysis for both freshwater and marine fish, but here I'm going to focus only on the freshwater parts. And you can see here are represented the phylogeny of the fish with the different values that we estimated, with CTmax values varying between 10 and 40 degrees Celsius. So the first thing that we did was to estimate the thermal safety margin for each species. So the difference between this physiological limit, the CTmax, and the temperature of the habitat, so meaning the mean temperature of the warmest month of the year seen across species ranges. And so we obtained one value per species. And we did that for historical baseline temperature scenario and a future one. And we use here what is called the RCP 8.5 scenario, which is the worst case scenario with a global increase around the surface of the globe of about 4 degrees Celsius by the end of the century. And here is what we obtain. On this graphic are represented the thermal safety margins, so each dot is one species, and the colors, so the clearer ones, they indicate the values that were estimated versus the darker one, the values that we directly found in the literature. And it's represented, the thermal safety margin, as a function of the latitudinal midpoint of species. And as you can see, we found that the species living currently closer to the thermal limit were the species occurring in the tropics, which was consistent with the expectations from terrestrial organisms. However, like incorporating the climate exposure into the picture, we found that high latitude species will be the most were predicted to be the most at risk, and notably the species located between 40 and 60 degrees of latitude north, which was unexpected. So we decided to go one step further and to try to understand the geography of this vulnerability. And to do so, we divided the world into 1 degree of latitude, 1 degree of longitude pixels. And for each grid cell, we calculated the average species thermal safety margins by considering all the species knowing to occur in this particular area. And so on this map are represented the thermal safety margin at the faunal level, and with the colors, so red indicates like really low values, so a higher vulnerability, and blue higher values of TSM, meaning that the species were living like way farther from these limits. And we found something really consistent with the species level analysis, meaning that assemblages located at relatively high latitude north were predicted to be the most vulnerable to future climate change. But if you look at the map, we also found a lot of variability, and we actually found areas where the vulnerability was predicted to be higher, as along the Pacific Northwest in the US, around the Caspian area, and in Eastern Asia. Finally, we decided to look at the overlap between this climatic vulnerability and other non-climatic pressures. And to do so, we collected information that, so indexes that were published describing several threats to freshwater organisms, such as the density of dams, the degree of pollution, and also biological factors related to the percentage of non-native invaders we just heard about. And here is what we found. So this is the comparison between these thermal safety margins at the faunal level and the degree of human pressures. And each dot represents the mean values for different regions of the world. And we found a really strong overlap between this climatic threat and these non-climatic pressures, meaning that the areas predicted to be the most at risk from future climate change were also the one currently experiencing the highest levels of threats. So to conclude on this first part, we saw that high latitude fish faunas will be increasingly vulnerable to climate change, which is in contrast with previous studies based on terrestrial organisms, which means that, contrary to common beliefs, high-latitude fish won't be physiologically shielded from global warming. And it also indicates, which is really interesting, is that the knowledge from the terrestrial and marine systems is hardly transferable to freshwater organisms, meaning that we have to develop new methodologies incorporating the peculiarities of freshwater systems to be able to predict and anticipate future consequences of climate change on these organisms. We also found that the areas, the currently the predicted to be the most affected by future climate change were also the most affected by other human pressures, which indicates that human activities may compromise species' adaptive capacity, so their capacity either to move to other areas, to relocate, but also their capacity to show evolutionary adaptations. And it highlights the need for proactive management strategies, because if we think about it, we can realize that it will be much easier to decrease the impact of other non-climatic pressures, which are often local in extent, rather than to really fight climate change, which requires international collaboration among different countries. And we have seen so far that implementing such global scale policies are extremely difficult. And in particular, I would like to highlight the potential of restoring stream connectivity to allow these organisms to move from downstream areas to more upstream areas in high latitude areas, which are currently highly fragmented. Moving on to the second part of my talk. So I'm going to present evidence from recent effect of climate change on the freshwater fish. And I'm going to start with the review that we did with collaborators in 2013. And so we went back to the literature again and to try to understand what were already published and what we knew about recent effects of climate change. And not surprisingly, so this graphic shows the number of articles that we found. And we compared the number of articles dealing with observations in red versus with predictions, the dotted line. And that was not surprising to find that many more studies were published reporting like predicted impact than the ones that were reporting recently observed impact. And so by reviewing these papers, we decided to focus on habitat suitability, which was with changes in habitat suitability, which was the effect the most commonly reported in the literature for both observations and predictions. And we decided to classify this effect as positive, meaning an increase in habitat size versus a decrease, so a negative effect on habitat suitability of fish. And we classified these published effects according to the different fish families. So not surprisingly, we found that the majority of our studies reported observed impact for two different freshwater fish families, the Salmonidae and the Cyprinidae. But more surprisingly, we found that instead of reporting only negative effects of climate change, which we might have expected, studies were reporting both positive and negative effects. And they were reporting these effects not only for different fish families, but even among the same family. So for example, the Salmonidae, so this is a family of the salmons and trouts, which are cold water fish species, and we usually expect them to be highly vulnerable to the changes in temperature. And we found that about half of the effects that were already published in the literature reported a positive effect, so an increase in the habitat suitability of the species to climate change, to the recent changes, just over the last decades. So this was a bit surprising. And other families, such as the Perseidae, only positive impacts were reported. So there was a lot of variability, but surprisingly, a lot of positive effects. So instead of finding that there were only losers of climate change, so species detrimentally affected by it, there was also species that benefited from it, which I called here the winners of climate change. And even more interestingly, we found that by comparing the observed to the predicted effect, that the recent observations of an impact of climate change were reporting effects that were usually more optimistic or more pessimistic than predicted impact. So it meant that the ecological models used to predict the future habitat suitability of species were somehow doing a bad job, and that we were clearly missing many different factors and mechanisms into these ecological models. So I'm not now going to present results about a second study that we did, and in which we try to quantify potential distributional range shift of freshwater fish species along the elevation gradient. We did that in France between two different time periods, a relatively cold period in 1980 to 1992, and a warmer contemporary period from 2003 to 2009. And to do that, we calculated changes along in the lower limit of the distribution of species along the elevation gradients, so at lower latitudes. And this process describes the disappearance of the individuals from several areas that became not suitable anymore, so usually too warm. And we also quantify changes in the upper limit of their distribution along the elevation gradient, describing colonization of newly suitable areas. And we did that for 32 fish species, the most common fish species in France. And so here are reported the changes at the upper elevation limit versus here at the lower elevation limit. Each dot represents one species. The gray colors indicate overall upslope shift of the species, and the darker colors, black colors, represent an overall downslope shift. And as you can see, we found that most of these species had shifted their distribution to higher elevation between these two time periods. And if you pay closer attention to the values for these upper and lower elevational shifts, you can realize that the shift that we quantified, estimated along the upper elevation limit, were much higher than at the lower limits, which indicated that most of these species were expanding their distribution to higher elevation instead of really shifting their range, which was consistent with the meta-analysis that we performed before, showing many positive, so increase in habitat size of the species in response to recent climate change. So we decided to try to understand why there was a variability among the different, the 32 fish species in their rate of change at these two limits of their distribution, and why the rates of extirpation, so the shifts at the lower limit, were different than at the upper limit. And so we decided to consider several species characteristics to explain these changes. And we consider first the thermal safety margin, so the physiological sensitivity of species, but other characteristics too linked to their trophic position, so whether the fish species were herbivorous, omnivorous, or piscivorous, factors related to their mobility, so the shape of their body, factor related to the fecundity, so whether or not it was a really highly fecund species with really short life cycles, and factors related to the size of their range. So here I represented the strength of the association that we found between the shift at the lower elevation limit and the characteristics of species. And as you can see, we found that regarding this rate of extirpation, extent of extirpation, we found that the thermal safety margin was the best predictor of this extirpation risk, which was actually good for our global assessment, because it demonstrates that, yes, we can use these physiological limits to assess the vulnerability to future extinction. However, regarding the colonization, we found something like completely different. We found that to explain the shift at the upper limit of the distribution of species, so at really high elevations, we had to incorporate several species characteristics, and the thermal safety margin wasn't involved anymore. Actually, we found that the two main characteristics of species linked to this distributional range shift were the trophic position, with piscivorous species shifting at a much faster rate, and species with really highly fecund species with short life cycles. Which means that global assessments based only on physiological vulnerability were actually missing something. And it's probably why in the prediction that we saw that were like less variable and less dramatic than the observations, because other species characteristics and apparently linked to really complex mechanisms were involved in the responses of species. And finally, for this study, we wanted to compare the rates that we obtained for the fish to the rates that were obtained for other taxonomic groups. And going back to the meta-analysis of Chen and collaborators published in 2011, so here are represented the observed elevational shift for other terrestrial taxonomic groups. So you have different dots, and each dot represents the mean rate for one particular group. So you have one dot for gastropods, one dot for birds, one dot for butterflies, one dot for lizards. And these observed elevational shifts, they are represented as a function of the expected elevational shifts, which was calculated as the rate of shift of the isotherms through space over the same period of time. And we wanted to add a dot with the freshet of fish in this plot. And so we calculated to the velocity of climate change, so the rate at which the isotherm they shifted across the French hydrographic network, and so in elevation, so along the mountain slopes. And here is what we found. We finally added our blue dot to this plot, and we found that the rates of range shift observed for freshwater organisms were actually really similar to the ones reported for many of these other taxonomic groups, which was surprising because given all the constraints existing on the distribution of freshwater fish species, we might have thought that they weren't able to really follow these shifting isotherms. But if you look at the of the plot too, we can see that this dot is still below the 1-1 line, indicating a perfect tracking for the organisms. Meaning that even if these rates were relatively fast for freshwater organisms, they were still not fast enough to allow them to follow the rate at which the climate was changing against the elevation gradient. In one last example, I'm going to present a study that I did recently with collaborators at the University of Tennessee, and in which we looked at changes in community composition. Indeed, we found with the previous studies that many fish species were experiencing changes in their distribution. Some of them were increasing, but some of them were also decreasing. Some of them were shifting, but not all at the same rate. So we asked, is it possible to find a global imprint of climate change on fish communities worldwide? And to do that, to test this question, we collected a time series of fish community abundances in different parts of the world. So this effort took 2 years to be able to collect about 12,000 time series, so describing the abundances of different fish species through time at the same site. So the time window that we have that is covered by this time series is 1959-2018, with an average of 18 years long, meaning that this time series were really good at covering the last 2 decades. And as you can see, we found here is represented a map with the different time series, so the sites for which we collected information. And even if we still have a bias towards the northern hemisphere, so we found most of the information from the US and European countries, we still were able to collect information on other regions of the world, which was absolutely great. And so to test an imprint of climate change, we decided to focus on the temperature affinities of the species composing the communities. And so if we take the example of this theoretical community here, a really simple one, composed of only one fish species with a really low temperature affinity. So the temperature affinity that we calculated is one mean value of seen across species range. Okay, so we assume that what we could observe across species ranges were representative of the their temperature affinities or preferences. But so imagine this particular community, we go back another year, and this time we find that there's not only species one, but there's also another species, species two, with higher temperature preferences, meaning that there's a general increase in the community temperature affinity. Imagine that for the same site, we go back a third time, and in this case, we see that species one had disappeared, so the species with really low thermal preferences, and instead, there's an addition of two species, species three and species four, with really high temperature affinities. So in this case, we could have seen like a gradual replacement of cold water species by warm water species, a process that I called a thermophilization of communities, assuming that these changes reflect the changes in the environment of species. So species one had disappeared because the climate wasn't favorable enough for it, and other species arrived because the water was warmer. So, and because throughout all my talk, I talk about temperature, but we also know that precipitation, the changes in the precipitation regime will be important and are expected. And the presence of water is so important for freshwater organisms, but also the presence of flowing water. Because many freshwater fish and riverine fish, they have their life histories like finely tuned to the particularities of the flow regime occurring across their habitat, in their habitat. So we know that it's really important for them. So we decided to look not only at temperature preferences, but also at discharge preferences, so the flow preferences of species. And we described, we tried to describe the mean community discharge affinity, and to try to detect gradual replacement of species from upstream areas, so characteristic of low discharge, but really fast flow, so what we call the rheophilic species, and the replacement of these species by species coming from downstream areas with a characteristic of a lot of discharge, really high discharge, and but really slow flows, so the limnophilic species, which I refer here as the limnophilization of communities. So I'm going to present the results of what we found, and here are represented for each square the percentage of the communities for each combination of increase or decrease in community temperature affinity and limnophilization or rheophilization of communities. And as you can see, we found that in 52% of the communities, we found an increase in the representation of warm water and downstream, so limnophilic species. And notably, we found an increase in the temperature preferences of species of 0.06 degrees per decade at the worldwide scale, which seems to demonstrate a global imprint of climate change on fish communities in many different parts of the world. However, we also found some variability. So, because for some communities, we found a decrease in the thermal preferences, and even in the rate of increase, there were some differences. So we looked at the spatial patterns, and again, we couldn't identify something really clear, for example, along the latitudinal gradients, and it seemed that in all the regions, we found increases and decreases. So even if the global trend was towards an increase in the representation of warm water and limnophilic species, still there was a lot of variability that we couldn't really answer. So we decided to try to explain these changes in community composition by trends in water temperature and discharge over the same period of time. And we also considered an additional factor related to the degree of human pressures. To do that, we considered the percentage of urban and agricultural lands around the sites. And we indeed found that the synergy between the recent climate changes in water temperature and discharge and the human pressures were explaining these changes in community composition the best. So for example here, for the community temperature affinity, we found that under really low human pressures, there was a slight increase, so a response of the biological communities to these changes, but under a much higher degree of human pressures, the slope was like much steeper, meaning that the response of the biological communities was much faster. And we found exactly the same pattern for the changes in discharge affinity. So you can see here that there was an increase in the community discharge affinity when the discharge had increased over the same period of time, but under low human pressures, but under high human pressure, the change was much higher than expected just based on the climatic changes. So to conclude on this part, we have seen, I hope that I convinced you, that freshwater fish have already been affected by climate change through multiple processes, changes in habitat suitability, distributional ranges, community reorganization. And we've seen that the interaction with other non-climatic drivers may result in larger impacts than otherwise anticipated, which is especially concerning as we found, at least for French fish, that species were already lagging behind climate change. And we know that freshwater systems are particularly threatened by multiple threats. And it likely indicates that we could see an increase in negative impacts in the future. So even if I showed that some species actually benefited from climate change, some of them were increasing their range, there might be actually a delay in the number of extinctions. And so we might see in the future in the an increase in negative impacts. And so given the complexity of the mechanisms involved, I think it is now more important than ever to implement repeatable monitoring programs, to be able to fill some of these knowledge gaps and to try to establish baselines against which the changes they could be monitored, understood, and anticipated. Thank you for your attention.